The following is a news and public affairs presentation of West Virginia Public Broadcasting. Good afternoon. I'm John Hingsbergen. Welcome to West Virginia Public Broadcasting's live coverage of the inauguration ceremony of Earl Ray Tomblin as governor of West Virginia. This is an historic day. It's apparently the first time this in the state's history that a governor will be taking the oath of office on a date other than the one set by the West Virginia state constitution. Joining me in the studio is public broadcasting host and producer Beth Vorhees. Good afternoon, Beth.
And good afternoon. It wasn't that long ago, John, that we were sitting at this very set in November 16th, 2010, and we were hosting the investiture ceremony for Earl Ray Tomblin. He became acting governor. He even took an oath that said he would act as governor. And so much has happened in the year since that November day. So much has happened to lead us to this day.
Today, then, is the actual formal inauguration of Earl Ray Tomblin as 35th governor of the state. I mean, had he not been elected in October, he would have been in the history books as an acting governor,
right,
and not actually taken a spot as one of the count of governors.
That's right. There would have been some sort of inauguration, certainly. But the legislature met this morning in a joint assembly. They heard from Secretary of State Natalie Tennant present them the election results of the October 4th general election. It was the legislature's job then to certify and declare that Earl Ray Tomblin won that election. He took an oath of office in private by a Supreme Court justice, probably in the governor's office. Every governor does that. There is this transition that they want to do. Every governor does that. And then there is this public oath taking, this kind of ceremony to celebrate not only the fellow who's going to be governor, but also the state of West Virginia. It's kind of a time when everybody of West Virginia state government gets together and really kind of celebrates the state. But
today's festivities are happening at this day because of an ruling by the West Virginia Supreme Court.
As I said, so much has happened since you and I first sat here during that investiture ceremony. That was in November. In December, lawsuits were filed contending that Tomblin could not be acting governor until the November 2012 election.
That would have been 2 years.
That's right. And that was filed by the Citizens Action Group of Charleston and Thornton Cooper, who is a South Charleston attorney. Tomblin and his lawyers contended that state law supported his position that he should be allowed to be acting governor until that 2012 election. House Speaker Rick Thompson didn't see it that way, however. He called for a special election very early on because he wanted to run for governor. So he wanted that primary election as well. In the meantime, in all of this, you had an acting governor, you had an acting Senate president with an entirely new leadership in the state Senate, and that caused for a pretty tense situation because you had new leadership, but you also had Earl Ray Tomblin, acting Senator Jeff Kessler, and House Speaker Rick Thompson all wanted to run for governor. So it made for a very tense session during the last legislative session.
We hope to talk further about what's going to happen from this day forward. A lot more activity even this very week. But as our viewers can see from our satellite feed from the state capitol right now, the dignitaries, state officials, are arriving for the ceremony.
And finally, this all worked out that the Supreme Court did hear arguments. And they heard the case in January and ruled that the legislature must set dates for a special primary election. The House and Senate went round and round about when these elections should be held, finally settling on May 14th for the primary. And then the general election on October 4th, and those election results were certified according to the West Virginia Constitution this morning. And so you see several dignitaries are coming down the steps of the state capitol.
The Honorable Mike Hall, Senate Minority Leader.
Very well, hear some music. Landau Eugene Murphy, the winner of NBC's America's Got Talent, is there and is going to sing.
He's already processed in just a few moments ago. Tom Haywood is, I guess, the master of ceremonies, the voice that we're hearing.
Tom Haywood is a Charleston attorney, very well known and highly regarded in political circles. This is really a Democratic party. All the Democratic Executive Committee is there. This is really a party for the Democrats. The House is there. The State Senate is there. We're seeing Majority Leader John Unger walk down the steps. That's the mayor of Charleston, Danny Jones. So again, this is kind of an occasion where everyone gets together and celebrates the state of West Virginia and the transition, the peaceful transition of government. As in flux as this past year has been, you know, it all worked out in the end. The Supreme Court heard arguments. The Supreme Court ruled, everybody obeyed, there were elections, both a primary and a general. It all went the way it's supposed to go with candidates running campaigns. And finally you get to this particular day. And Earl Ray Tomblin has been in the legislature for 34 years. He's been in the legislature. He's been in the Senate since 1980 and became Senate president, I think, in the 1990s sometime. I should have looked that one up. But this is what the Senate president, this is what Earl Ray Tomblin always hoped would happen, that one day he would be able to be governor. He thought he could just step into that role, but it turned out the Supreme Court said, no, you can't just step into that role. There has to be an election. You have to be elected. So that's how we came to today in an inauguration ceremony.
As the dignitaries continue to file in, the ceremony scheduled for 3 o'clock. Of course, it takes a little while to get everyone in place for an event of this type. Apparently, the weather has held out very nicely. There was a little concern earlier this morning. Things were kind of gray and cloudy, but I know the official forecast called for partly sunny skies this afternoon. It looks like a nice day for what we can see on camera at the moment. No one seems to be shivering out there in the mid-60s.
It's better than a January inauguration.
I'll bet.
There have been some very cold January inaugurations, and this is interesting that this inauguration, the Supreme Court said, look, you have to have a governor elected within 1 year of Joe Manchin leaving office. That was on November 15th, 2010. The state Supreme Court said, you've got to have another governor elected by then, by that November 15th. Therefore, it was decided that to do this on a Sunday rather than on a weekday in November, when the legislature is here anyway for their monthly interim meetings, this is a good time to do it. Walking down the steps right now, Secretary of State Natalie Tennant and her daughter Delaney. This is Congresswoman Shelley Moore Capito and her husband Charlie Capito. So there is a Republican invited to this party. It's not all Democrats. The congressional delegation is here as well. Congressman Nick Joe Rahal now walking down the steps.
From the United States
he
Senate,
is the third district Joe congressman. Manchin Capito III. Represents
and
the
as
second
you mentioned,
district.
Beth, the former governor Joe Manchin, now arriving Senator Joe Manchin.
That's right. Senator Joe Manchin is here. And he's, you know, what occurred is what, well, you know, Senator Robert Byrd died. Mm-hmm. You had to have an election for a senator. Manchin chose to run. He won that race. He left the governor's office, and that set in every single motion that we have leading to this very day, this very hour, when Earl Ray Tomlin will take that oath.
So all of this really got set into motion at the end of June of last year when Senator Byrd passed.
Mm-hmm.
And we would have known that that's exactly what was going to happen. This entire chain of succession was put into place.
The only wrinkle in that was the idea by many, not only Earl Ray Tomlin, but many that said, the president can act as governor until there is a new election. That was the wrinkle that had to be ironed out by the state Supreme Court. Other than that, it's all gone according to plan. Earl Ray Tomlin has been in the legislature since 1974. He was 22 years old when he was first elected to the House of Delegates. So for the first time in a long time, Earl Ray Tomlin is not a member of the state legislature. He is governor and in charge of the executive branch.
To the tune of Ruffles and Flourishes, Governor Earl Ray Tomblin and First Lady Joanne
Jager Tomblin
are, and their son Brent are now processing in for today's inaugural ceremony at the state capitol. Mm-hmm. The river side of the state capitol, there are
the south side. Inaugurations, I've seen several of them now, and they go from south side to north side. The last one was on the north side. This one's on the south side. It kind of goes back and forth between, usually in January, they like to do it on the north side because it's a little, the Capitol kind of protects you from the weather a little bit. But I have seen January inaugurations on the south side, right there by the river.
The ceremony begins with...
You may be seated. Welcome to the inauguration of the 35th governor of the state of West Virginia, Earl Ray Tomblin. Governor Tomblin is one of the chief architects of West Virginia's fiscal strength and stability over the past 20 years. Today, we are the envy of the nation as a result of his work with scores of other leaders in our state, many of whom are seated before you. Governor Tomblin is humble. He loves West Virginia. He cares deeply for every West Virginian. He has a quick wit and a great sense of humor. He takes the time to inform himself on issues facing our state and carefully and respectfully considers all points of view on the issues before him. He is willing to make a decision, even when it is a tough one. Governor Tomblin genuinely enjoys working with and learning from others. He is a deeply devoted family man and loves his wife and family. Earl Ray Tomblin is one of us through and through. This past year, the people of West Virginia have come to know what those in Governor Tomblin's home county of Logan and the West Virginia legislature have known for many years: that we are blessed to have a man of such experience, ability, and integrity step forward to lead our state. Today, we celebrate a major milestone in the public service journey embarked upon by Governor Tomblin almost four decades ago. Seated on the Capitol steps this afternoon are some very special West Virginians. Among this group, you will see many of the friends and family of our governor. And at this time, please recognize especially the directors, commissioners, and heads of executive departments across state government. They and the many public servants who serve with them strive daily to provide citizens across West Virginia the valued and expected services of state government. As they stand, please let them know how much we all appreciate them. The inaugural ceremony is an affirmation of the power of our democratic process, a major and rightly anticipated state event that is shared with great pride by all West Virginians. This ceremony is the centerpiece of a great day. Let us begin now by standing for the posting of colors by the West Virginia Combined Color Guard, the singing of the national anthem by Landau Eugene Murphy, Jr., and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Major General James A. Hoyer. Please stand.
say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
America's Got Talent winner from West Virginia, Landau Eugene Murphy, with the national anthem.
Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in the pledge to our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands. One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Yeah, when as he begins to step on.
Please be seated. The inaugural invocation will be given by Monsignor Sadie of the Basilica of the Co-Cathedral of the Sacred Heart.
Let us pray. Yahweh, Heavenly Father, Allah, the one creator and sustainer of all life, comforter of the afflicted, strength of the weak, how wonderful your name in all the earth. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you, we give you thanks for your great glory. You have blessed our state with great beauty and abundant resources. But the principal glory of your creation will always be the people you call your own. We gather to invoke your blessing on Earl Ray Tomblin, whom we have chosen to give direction to our efforts to bring health of mind and body to the families and individuals of our state. Grant him wisdom to discern and the strength to do what in your sight is good for us. Inspire him with courage to face the challenges that beset such heavy responsibilities, and after his tenure as governor, let him hear all West Virginians echo your words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have served my people well." Amen.
The invocation there from Monsignor P. Edward Sadie of the Co-Cathedral of the Sacred Heart in Charleston. This is the inauguration of Earl Ray Tomblin as 35th governor of West Virginia on West Virginia PBS and West Virginia Public Radio on this bright and sunny, somewhat windy Sunday afternoon. But as Beth pointed out earlier, far better conditions than an inauguration that would be occurring in mid-January.
Sometimes January, it's very cold for an inauguration. Sometimes not so much. You just really never know. But this is a very lovely setting on a fall day in November. Next, we'll be hearing My Home Among the Hills by the Parkersburg High School Chamber Choir. Landau Eugene Murphy performing at the inauguration. He's performing in sellout concerts across the state. He'll be going back to Las Vegas soon. He's really done very, very well. West Virginia is very proud of him.
I think the Clay Center has added a third performance of his upcoming concert.
They have, and it was sold out too. So he's a very popular man in West Virginia. Here again is Tom Haywood.
Always a lovely element of our ceremony, the Parkersburg High School Chamber Choir, directed by Miss Pamela McLean, will sing My Home Among the Hills by E.W. James, Jr.
Parkersburg High School Chamber Choir under the direction of Mrs. Pamela McLean. my home among the hills.
I would now ask that we all stand for the inaugural prayer given by Reverend Doug Craven of First Presbyterian Church of Logan, West Virginia, and for the administering of the oath of office by Chief Justice Margaret Workman of the West Virginia Supreme Court of Appeals to Governor Earl Ray Tomblin. I would then ask that you remain standing for a 19-gun salute to the governor. Reverend Craven.
Governor Tomblin, Mrs. Tomblin, Brent, your family, friends, members of the judiciary, the House, Senate, honored guests, let us now take a few moments to turn to God in prayer as we bow our heads for this wonderful moment. Let us pray. Mighty God, creator of all things, we thank you today for the honored privilege of appearing together in your presence on this historic and solemn occasion for the inauguration of Earl Ray Tomblin as the governor of the wonderful state of West Virginia. Lord, today this state and our nation face times of uncertainty, uncertainty concerning our economy, education, health care, and even the basics of day-to-day life. Thus, Lord, we humbly turn to you and ask for your guidance and blessing for Earl Ray, his family, and all those that seek to lead our state. Lord, as we look to the past, we are encouraged through the foundations of hope, seen in the examples of courage and wisdom given to us by our forefathers in our state and our nation, that showed the world that hope in times of challenge and uncertainty. West Virginia's first governor, Arthur Borman, spoke of such things that would empower the fledgling state, as it too was engaged in a time of uncertainty known as the Civil War. Governor Borman spoke of advancing mining and agriculture, manufacturing and education. He spoke of the need to work closely with the House and Senate to create a powerful and prosperous future. Lord, we know that these considerations are as important today as they were in 1863. Lord of knowledge and power, we ask that you inspire Governor Tomblin and lead him and allow him to understand what the scripture speaks to us in the Psalms. Unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. Likewise, George Washington, in his farewell address to the nation, stated that faith is a foundation of morality and that both faith and morality are key components of a strong society. Thus, Lord, please allow this administration to see how these foundations can create greater potential for the people of this state and our nation. Finally, Lord, we ask that you give Governor Tomblin and the leaders of this state the wisdom and the courage to see beyond themselves and to empower them in such a way that allows this to be the dawning of a new day and a new era for them and for West Virginia. We pray this in your most precious and holy name. Amen.
Reverend Doug Craven of the First Presbyterian Church of Logan, West Virginia.
I, Earl Ray Tomblin, do solemnly swear.
I, Earl Ray Tomblin, do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of West Virginia.
And the Constitution of the State of West Virginia.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties.
Of the office of Governor of the State of West Virginia.
Of the office of Governor of the State of West Virginia.
To the best of my skill and judgment.
To the best of my skill and judgment.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations, Governor.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Gun salute from the 1st Battalion of the 201st Field Artillery.
It's always very loud over there by the Capitol when they do this, but this is a tradition during any inauguration ceremony is to have this 19 gun salute to the governor of West Virginia.
Why 19, Beth?
I don't know. 19.
Must be some significance.
Well, we'll find out. Google that, and we'll be right back at you.
Now, the new governor will be presented by his predecessor, who is now a United States Senator, the Honorable Joe Manchin III, up next at the podium during today's inaugural ceremony.
Please be seated. This is the first inauguration I've been to where you can feel your fingers and your toes at the same time. Today's a very proud day for me to stand with all of you and my dear friend, Governor Earl Ray Tomblin. We stand together on this day as leaders of a great and strong state, a state that truly stands out in our great nation in these challenging times. A state that doesn't cut the vital services to those in need. A state that sets its priorities based on its values, taking care of our children, taking care of our elderly, and taking care of our veterans. A state that continues to confront. Let's hear it for our veterans. A state that continues to confront its challenges head on by bringing all sides together to support common sense solutions. A state that has a budget surplus. A state that has a credit rating that was increased 3 times in the past 3 years. A state that simply lives within its means. And because of all that, we are a state that succeeds. I'm proud of the legacy that my administration built as governor. But make no mistake, no one person, not even a governor, can accomplish any of this alone. There are so many people who are responsible, friends, foes, and allies, who fought for the future of our state instead of their own agendas. We didn't always agree, but we always put our state first. And one of those people who made this team so strong is Earl Ray Tomblin, a true public servant who will take our state into the future. Public service should be the noblest of all professions, and it should truly be about serving others and not yourself. Unfortunately, this is not what we are seeing in Washington today, but I know that we can change government, which is not working today in Washington. And the reason that I have so much faith is because we did it together here in West Virginia. Our differences didn't divide us, they became our starting point. We never fixed a problem by blaming others. Instead, we worked together. We put politics and partisanship aside, and we did what was right for our state. And we will continue to do this with Earl Ray Tomblin leading us. The powerful example of our state's success, whether it's balancing the budget, reforming major programs like workers' comp, taking care of our citizens, this is West Virginia's story of success, and it is just the beginning. I've always said that I believe in you more than you believe in yourself, but just look at what happened when we all started believing in each other. And I believe Governor Tomblin will be the leader who will continue to bring people together. He will be a leader who will make decisions on what is best for our state. And Governor Tomblin will lead our state into a better future because West Virginia's best days are still ahead of us. Ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to present to you the right leader at the right time for all of West Virginia's future, the governor of our great state, Earl Ray Tomblin.
U.S. Senator Joe Manchin III introducing Governor Earl Ray Tomlin, who has now stepped to the podium to deliver the inaugural address.
Thanks. Thank you.
Since 1974, when he was 22 years old, he's quite an experienced legislator.
Thank you.
And
thank
now,
you very
his
much.
Inaugural address, just
Good
like
afternoon,
last year.
Good afternoon, my fellow West Virginians. Thank you for this tremendous opportunity to have been chosen as the chief executive of our great state. I promise that each and every day I will honor your trust and build upon the privilege of being your governor. To Senator Manchin, thank you for your kind words. All West Virginians are deeply appreciative of what you did as our governor and now as our senator following the untimely death of our beloved Senator Byrd. Also want to extend my thanks to Senator Rockefeller, who is unable to join us today. We thank you, Senator, for all that you have done and continue to do for our state. I also want to offer my thanks to all my supporters who have worked so hard this past year to make this day a reality. I am humbled by the depth and broad base of support that so many of you offered to this effort. To the hundreds of volunteers who constantly burn the midnight oil, but with one single expectation, and that was for a better West Virginia, I thank you. And a special thank you to Tom Haywood. Tom is a great friend, and I want to thank him for being our master of ceremonies for today's event. Thank you, Tom. Appreciate you. More importantly, I want to thank all of you, the citizens of our great state, who have come to be part of this today. Your presence has made this a special day for my family and me. To my many family members and dear friends, please know how much I appreciate you being here, and I just want to say thank you for your love and encouragement over the years. To my lovely wife, Joanne, and our son, Brent, You mean the world to me. Your love, support, and belief in me can never be matched or measured. I wouldn't be here today without you. I stand here today a proud son of Chapmanville, West Virginia. It was in my hometown and from my dear and wonderful parents that I learned the values of family, faith, community, and hard work that continue to guide me to this day. And I have seen those deep-rooted values in the many people that I've met as I've traveled all around our Great Mountain State. Today, I am honored to be sworn in as the 35th governor of West Virginia. As your humble servant, I will work every day to bring people together to do what is best for all of West Virginia. From the northern and eastern panhandles to the southern coal fields,
We are influenced by our geographic locations, but we are united by our desire to move our state forward and make it all that it can be. 12 months ago, I started working as your governor. I focused on creating jobs, lowering taxes, and moving West Virginia forward. Today, as I officially become governor, my priorities remain clear and steadfast. I've had the honor to serve as president of the West Virginia Senate for 17 years, and for the past 37 years, serving in the legislature, I have represented the coal miners, the shopkeepers, teachers, and working people from my district. During that time, I worked with governors and legislators from both parties with one common goal, and that was to put West Virginia first. Over the past year, you've heard me say those four words very often, put West Virginia first. Each day, I rise to lead our state with that intention, to put West Virginia first with every decision that I make. Together we've made some tough choices during tough, difficult times, and those decisions are now paying dividends. We made sound decisions for the long term, not for the next election. And I will continue leading with that long-term view. When it came to putting our fiscal house in order, and tackling issues like workers' compensation reform, keeping our doctors here in West Virginia, and reforming our tax structure, we have one guiding principle, and that was to put West Virginia first. Now, as your governor, I will continue to lead with that focus so that those sound decisions that we can make West Virginia an even better place for our citizens. While there's still work to be done and the national recession is still present, we have much to be proud of here. Our state budget is not just balanced, we continue to have a surplus. Our credit rating is higher than it's been in decades, and our rainy day fund is the envy of the entire nation. We are cutting taxes for consumers and business alike, and I'm proud to say that by the end of my term, the food tax on the sales tax on food will be completely eliminated. As governor, nothing is more important than encouraging and advancing our state's economic future. Our unemployment rate is below the national average. We have attracted national companies like Macy's and Amazon, and I will work hard to attract even more. I want to repeat that I will go anywhere and do anything to bring even more good-paying jobs to West Virginia. We live in a special place. We are the hardest working people in America. We power the world. Our heritage of being the nation's leading energy provider will continue throughout the 21st century. We must continue to promote our energy industry. Our nation and our state and our great citizens depend on West Virginia to power their future. I will work tirelessly to defend these industries. I will fight for our state's coal industry, the backbone of our economy. We will continue to take on the federal government and oppose efforts by the EPA and others to stop production of the most efficient fuel our country knows. Now, we are on the forefront of new energy sources and new technologies with the development of the Marcellus Shale. Working with members of the legislature, we will put permanent rules in place to provide certainty to the natural gas industry while also protecting landowners and our environment. And with this certainty, we will see our manufacturing sector rejuvenated by taking advantage of natural gas byproducts. I look forward to not just one, but hopefully two multi-billion dollar investments so our children can stay home, secure good paying jobs, and raise their families right here in West Virginia. To do this, we must work together. I'm a consensus builder. Business and labor can function harmoniously. Republicans and Democrats can work together, and no one part of the state is more important than the other. I will be a governor for all of West Virginia. My door is always open, and I know that the best solutions come after frank and honest discussions, and I look forward to having those opportunities. And while I'm proud to be financially conservative, I'm open to new ideas, new technology, and new ways to make our state better. Over the coming months, it is my intention to bring people together to rally around common goals that will better our state, improving our education system, reducing our drug abuse, and resolving our OPEB liability. I pledge to you that I will show West Virginia's can-do spirit, work through any potential gridlock, and make sure that we make progress on those and other critical issues facing our state. We must allow ourselves the opportunity to see all sides of the issues and challenges before us, because I believe that when we approach our challenges in this matter, we can and we will all succeed together. I will represent our state with pride and dignity. I won't let us be taken advantage of, and we will take a back seat to no one. This is a good place to start a business, a great place to raise a family. We are strong, resilient, and resourceful. West Virginians make things happen. We are West Virginia. I stand before you today, a common man upon which you have bestowed a great honor. I'm a man who works hard, shoots straight, loves his wife and son, and wakes up every day thinking about how I can make a great state even greater. It will take all of us working together, and with your support and God's will, I pledge to be the best governor that I can be. May God, thank you. May God bless you, may God bless America, and may God bless the great state of West Virginia. Thank you all so much.
From the Earl Ray Tomblin, his inaugural address, the 35th governor of West Virginia. Beth Vorhees, repeating some themes of the address he gave last year at the investiture ceremony. West Virginia first.
I wish I had reviewed that speech to see how closely this one resembled it. Certainly West Virginia first, and be the best governor that he can be, and working for families, and working for jobs, and working for manufacturing, and working for business. He's got another speech to give in just a few months. He'll give the State of the State address on January 11th, 2012.
Please remain standing for the retiring of the colors.
Wendell Eugene Murphy.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Virginian who rose to fame very quickly, Landau Eugene Murphy Jr., singing the benediction, Amazing Grace, the benediction for today's inaugural ceremony.
You know, as I look at the pictures here and hear Landau Eugene Murphy and hear Governor Tomblin now giving this inaugural address, this really closes a very unusual chapter in West Virginia's political history. Never again will there be a Senate president who will act as governor as long as Earl Ray Tomblin did, almost a year. The Supreme Court ruled that there had to be an election. The legislature then put it in code. The state law now reads, within 30 days from the date the vacancy occurs in the governor's office, the person acting as governor, pursuant to the state constitution, shall issue a proclamation fixing the time for a new statewide election to fill the vacancy in the office of governor. And it does talk about a special primary and a special general election and the time frames of when they need to happen. So there was a problem, it was fixed, and it was worked out.
Resolving the uncertainty of the past
year. Resolving all this uncertainty, certainly. And that's what legislatures are for, that's what courts are for. It's going to be a very busy week at the Capitol. I want to leave you with this. The Democratic Executive Committee of Logan County has to meet to nominate three people to replace Earl Ray Tomblin in the Senate. Tomblin will name that senator, and it better be quick, because the Senate will meet to elect a president. Acting Senate President Jeff Kessler is a candidate, so is Brooks McCabe of Kanawha County, so there could be some drama there. Also on Thursday, John, the Supreme Court will hear oral arguments about the House and Senate redistricting plan. And then you and I will be back here because there'll be another inauguration in January 2013. So there you go.
Thank you, Beth Vorhees. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, John.
Sharing the studio with you. You have been tuned to West Virginia Public Broadcasting's live coverage of the inauguration of Governor Earl Ray Tomblin. We'll have complete coverage of this event tomorrow on West Virginia Morning with Beth Vorhees. That's at 7:30 on West Virginia Public Radio, and a report on the ceremony on This Week in West Virginia. That's Friday night at 8 o'clock on West Virginia PBS. I'm John Hingsbergen. Thanks for tuning in.